A hard match to call, the Swedes versus the Finns, and we start things off here on Hollywood. Ben, are we going to see some crazy strats out of NIP? I want to see some Mana Love.
Yeah, I sure hope so, and this is a map where it could happen. In fact, I believe this is a map where it has happened for this team in the past, and we could potentially see something like Reinhardt, Zarya, Roadhog for the tanks, and then Ana, Lucio, Zenyatta for the supports.
Well, please, please.
We've been talking about it. Maybe talked it up too much. Now, if it doesn't happen, I'll feel a little disappointed.
Yeah, maybe they decide to go standard. But we can see Nana out of NIP straight away. And how many tanks do we have? We have the three. So this is the setup that's...
this is what we've been talking about.
Yeah.
We don't look dumb. We actually look smart for once. Let's do this. NIP going to be attacking first with this crazy strategy, this very non-standard stuff. And maybe a little bit of a false start here. Going to reset this one.
Now, we did actually see, I'm not sure if it would have stuck, but we saw a Junkrat, which can actually be commonly run on the first point there. I feel like a triple tank setup against a Junkrat could actually work very well, because Junkrat's very annoying when his damage is focused on just like the one shield, let's say of a Reinhardt, and it breaks the shield down and it really destabilizes all the supports and the squishies behind. But if you don't have any squishies and you've got a Lucio speed boost, I feel like Junkrat doesn't get much of an opportunity to actually do much, basically, and have much value. So I really like that setup. I think it could work very well for NIP.
Yeah, I totally agree, because if you think about it, Ana is going to be healing everyone up like crazy. Of course, Ana has basically the best single-target healing in the game. So with this composition, they should theoretically be able to keep everyone very healthy. And also that Zarya is going to have a field day gaining charge super, super quick.
So yeah, I hope they don't run the Junkrat.
Let's hope we get this going quickly. And yeah. And Gringos don't, or Bringos, they used to be called Gringos, don't get a little bit of knowledge from that little quick moment there. But
quick hiccup, yeah.
Yeah. Hopefully we'll get this game going. And jumping on into Hollywood, which should be a fun one indeed. Actually, I think that we're going to see NIP probably switch up after that first point. Once you move on to the streets phase, it's all about getting that high ground control, and they don't really have any of that upward mobility. In fact, nobody that can get up and about. But for that first point, I love it.
Yeah, and it's interesting too, because, you know, I see a lot of, you know, two common approaches recently that have been popping up is either like a very high mobility approach where you've got your Tracers and your Genjis and the Winstons to just split up the defense and just launch yourself on there. And splitting up the defense is basically the name of the game and getting behind into the supports. But with the heavy tank setup, most of your DPS is probably going to be from the Zarya, so, but you have so much more of an ability to bully them off in these close range kind of choke points that we have in situations like the first point of Hollywood. So I really like it from that perspective as well. I don't know which is really better, actually.
Yeah, and you're totally right. I mean, attacking teams, there's pretty distinct approaches that you can take. And as you mentioned, one of which is the new dive composition, which isn't necessarily new, but it's really coming into prominence over the last couple of weeks, where you're going to be focusing around having a Tracer or a Genji and a Winston just jump into either right into the fray or into the back lines, look for an early pick. But this is actually the opposite. NIP is going to be slow and steady. They should, in theory, be able to push right in, though. I think this is going to be interesting to see as we get started. Map number one will be Hollywood between the Finns and the Swedes. Maybe?
Maybe.
Maybe?
Might have
perhaps?
Some more issues.
One more time.
Well,
darn.
I mean, I can add to your point there as well. It's one thing that we saw is that when you're running the payload as well, that setup with the Tracer and the Genji can be even better, because that slow-moving payload, you know, makes it, you know, much more valuable to actually split off the DPS and distract them to get yourself through those very nasty choke points. And but the problem with that as well is on the capture points, when you're going to claim the payload, as is the first point on Hollywood, it's hard to stay on there. I mean, maybe you can get the Genji and the Tracer kind of harassing for a while, but if you lose the bulk of your teammates, that's all they're going to be doing, really, just harassing, and eventually they just have to leave. So I like the ability that you can get the momentum very quickly, potentially with a very fast take. Because you can just sit your Reinhardt on there, sit your Zarya on there, and you can just sustain them for quite a while.
Yeah, and I think another thing to look out for is just going to be that Nana boost. I mean, we talked about Ana. We saw her being selected here. And on capture points, when you're going for one assault, it can be a Nana boost to change everything for the attacking team. Stick that, of course, on the Reinhardt is one of the most common targets that you're going to see Nana boosted. And even if the Reinhardt can't get a ton of kills himself, it's such a distraction. You have to all spread away from the Reinhardt as he comes in, and one of the things we've seen, one of the best ways to stop this is to charge that Reinhardt with the defensive Reinhardt, which we saw many, many times recently, but it's very hit or miss. You're not going to always hit that charge. So we'll see if that Nana boost does come on into play, as we're hopefully going to be getting right back into the game in just a second. It seems like one of our players is having a little bit of technical issues. Want to make sure that's all ironed out before we jump back in. But yeah, DDK, this should be a good one. And like we mentioned before, these two teams, they've been slugging it out in kind of the mid-tier of the European scene for a while now. And it would make a huge difference for either team to make it all the way to Atlanta, qualify through this group. And not to say that they're going to have an easy fight, even if they do win this one. B-Fly is yet another one of those teams that has stuck around for a while, has gotten experience. They've had some roster changes, but they could actually put up a decent fight against either one of these teams, regardless of who wins here.
Yeah, that's the exciting thing about the Overwatch Open, is that that second part, the Open, pretty much anybody can have the opportunity through this very open system to play the best teams and to make their mark. And as we've seen, and as you said on the desk, that, you know, these teams have been cropping up for ages. So they aren't exactly new, you know, new kids on the block. We have seen them for a while. But one thing I wanted to add, actually, before we move on from the Nano Boost thing, is that's actually been some of the most fun I've had on Ranked recently. When the on the PTR, when, you know, you had your placement matches right before, you know, I started studying some VODs for this tournament, I was just running just a duo with an Ana and a Zarya, and that was a lot of fun for all the placement matches.
Which one were you?
I was mostly the Zarya, actually.
Okay. Yeah.
So maybe that's why.
Were you
fun,
being boosted as Zarya?
Sometimes I was the Ana as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. But both heroes are very fun, and it is always super cool when you're Zarya and just no one can kill you.
Yeah.
And running around with a Nano Boost.
Dan, lucky you, actually having time to play PTR. Been on the road now for a couple of weeks and haven't had the chance yet. Can't wait to, though, man. So many interesting changes in that patch, and we'll see which of those actually make it into the final game.
Yeah, but I mean, I'm not going to lie. Most of us are sitting in the green room like, I want to play. I want to play. Can we play now?
Especially watching like all these Genjis go nuts. I'm like, oh, I want to play Genji right now.
It's interesting, actually. Of course, on the PTR, Genji had the nerf of the 6-second Dragon Blade. Do you think that's... How do you feel? Like, is that enough? Is that not enough?
Well, look, I mean, Genji can't really say he's like OP. Definitely can be a game changer when you in the hands of people like Shadowburn, in the hands of people like Tvik, in the hands of people like Kib.
What about Cypher, man? And
Cypher. Cypher's pretty good, too. I see the Quake bias shining
a little bit there.
Person
love there.
And Rafa's now playing a bunch of Genji for Team Liquid,
really?
Which we'll see later today. That should be pretty damn good in, I don't know, about like 6 hours from now, something like that. But Genji, look, a lot of people are saying, oh, he's done. No one's going to play Genji anymore. I think the sword nerf is actually very substantial. It's going to be 8-second duration down to 6. But the rest of the changes, I think people are really overestimating how much this is going to affect Genji. Some slight nerfs to his mobility, but
yeah,
I really don't think it's actually going to change things too much.
Yeah, that mobility nerf is a very, very interesting one, because we can see, I mean, that's one of the reasons why, like, when I last was watching Anox, I saw Cypher just taking these like ridiculous lines through enemies, just, you know, getting kill after kill all over the place. And mobility is really nuts, actually. Although that said, it was mostly the dash, the shift that is very, very powerful. But I think that also got nerfed. You can't, am I right? You can't. There's like a cooldown between the melee as well.
Yeah, so you can't do the right click melee dash combo instantaneously. You have to wait for the melee animation to finish before
so
you can
dash. Cancel it anymore.
And it's actually it's a fundamental change to the engine itself. With every other character, can't really melee cancel anymore in this PTR. But anyway,
big deal.
Enough about the PTR. Enough of the theory crafting. We're back on into Hollywood, and hopefully it sticks this time.
I think some of these games should become playable mini games, like Siege Mode with a Siege Tank. That was pretty fun. I was a Terran player in Brood War.
Oh, no! I thought you were about to say StarCraft 2. I was a Terran player in Brood War and StarCraft 2 as well.
I switched to Zerg in StarCraft 2. So.
Oh, traitor.
Yeah.
But here we go, Hollywood. Hoping to see this go through this time. No more reset Areno. War for Areno. That's going to be Hollywood. NIP on attack with this crazy 3-tank, 3-support composition. And I think they're probably, they're just kind of trolling right now. Zapis will be switching off some Metro, right? All right. Yes.
There we go. But we do have the Junkrat, which we were talking about. And this setup should, for NIP, should be able to be quite effective with the Zarya and the speed boost and all this, the help and the sustainability of these tanks. I'm looking forward to seeing this one, this first push.
Oh, actually, Mafu going to be stuck by the Junkrat trap. Didn't see it around the corner. but no harm, no foul as they continue to push straight in, and it's going to be behind that Reinhardt shield. Of course, Zarya bubbles will be up and about, and Zarya, Mafu already with 100 charge, and that feels pretty good as a Zarya player.
Yeah, so there we go. We've got Mafu just able to get a lot of damage in there. The Reinhardt is just standing large in charge mid, trying to just hold it down on the payload, but it is looking quite labored at this point. There's a lot of surface area for NIP to work with as they push forwards. Once again, Mafu just able to stand here out in the open. This is very, very problematic as well. And Anna's about to get the nano boost up and running. So there it is. Zappis has that nano boost, but Bringo's get the key frags. So Zappis is going to want to hold on to that nano boost as they start to fall back right now. It's going to have to be used on the second attack, I think.
Yep. 1 minute off the clock now, and NIP, they had this very calm, collected, slow moving, inching forward plan. Didn't really work though. The first kill went against NIP. Seita, the Lucio player, down and out of the action super, super quick then. They're in. Oh, here comes the nano boost, DDK.
Love the nano boost, and it is looking to be working fantastic. Nice hook coming in from Himzy, and everybody's dying. The Graviton comes in to add insult to injury. And what else are you going to do? That is everybody wiped, apart from Lidano there on the McCree. But he's not going to be able to do anything by his lonesome. So there you go. The nano boost gets it done.
Yeah, NIP had a game plan, and they did stick to it. It's going to be slow and steady wins the race as NIP picking up the first point in just about 100 seconds there. Not too bad, not too fast, not too slow. Interested to see if NIP does stick with this here. Again, this composition, it's like a battering ram. You're just going to be pushing forward with so much health, so much survivability, and actually a good amount of damage output. Zappas will be able to take some long-range shots as well as Ana. That said, they don't have any way to get up to the roof. But early pick by Himzy.
Yeah, he's going to have to do a lot of stuff like that because, as you say, there's no way to get up to the roof, and they don't really have any long-range hit scan to work with. What?
What?
Himzy gets himself number two, picking these targets off the roof. All right, then I guess there is a way to get up to the roof.
What? What is happening?
Again?
Himzy, stop it. That's not nice.
And look how far the payload's moved because of this.
Yeah, the payload just cruising straight through forward. Hasn't even been begun to slow down here as NIP looking so strong. But Lidano potentially working a big Deadeye will take out Ana. So finally, NIP will be slowed down after three very, very interesting hooks coming out of Himzy.
Yeah, and that's something that looks amazing, and it did move the payload some, but they can't really rely on all of those hooks. There is a few ultimates to work with, but again, it's going to be hard for them for Fraggy to get a good Earth Shatter unless they're able to first force down Bringo's to collapse onto the cart and get them onto the same level. And we'll have to see if they're going to be able to do that, as right now Bringo's just going to be laying in the damage. They really need a pick off before they have to be forced to go for the collapse onto the payload.
Yeah, Himzy looking for more miracle hooks, and he's actually not going to find it right here. He will go down to Shades, who's playing Genji, and Bringo's has found a way to put the brakes on this payload. Very strong here, and you know, I hate to sound like a broken record, but NIP really, honestly, I like this composition. I love seeing new, unique things, but at the same time, you got to feel like they need a Winston, and there you go. Winston is in play.
Yeah, absolutely. And potentially also maybe a McCree. Somebody that just can hit some hit scan on the mid ranges effectively and consistently. But so maybe the Winston is enough. We'll have to see. Bringo's have had good timing on their initiations. And let's see if they get another one. The nano boost is going to be dropped onto the Reinhardt there. And let's see if that's going to do much there for Fraggy as he tries to find some targets. And actually, it looks like it's going to go quite well here for NIP as they start to move onto that polo, start to get the frags. They force action here from Bringo's, but it's all on NIP right now.
Yeah, both Reinhardts will charge right on into each other. And now the fight is beginning to snowball out of control for NIP. They've gotten too many kills, and that's just going to allow them to move forward and collect this next point. That said, taking a look at the ultimate count for both teams, it is Bringo's with a slight advantage, and I don't like that push in right there. At least Shades did not waste the Dragon Blade. He will have it for the next fight.
So they have found a way to make this work. I would love to see the percentage there on Himzy, because not only is he hitting all the hooks, he's hitting some very difficult ones at that. Now, we have the push coming in to try to just move the payload more in. Bringo's have to be careful that they don't overstep here, as well as NIP. But NIP have all the confidence moving in for these aggressive plays, and also have to be careful they have enough people on the payload to make it move quickly enough.
Yeah, Bringo's had been overstepped for way too long there. They were all the way up to the gates. Even though they were down 5 versus 6, they were so far pushed forward, and that's a little bit of a misstep, I believe, for Bringo's. They held for a decent chunk of time there on the streets phase here on Hollywood, but they were just a little bit too far forward. Still enough time to slow this payload down as it does move onto the final few dozen meters here, but here comes Shades from behind. Will he be able to get any value with the Dragon Blade? Here it comes, coming out. He's in the back lines and he's unfettered at this point in time, able to get at least one kill. Two kills now going for Bringo's, and that should be enough to slow this down.
Yeah, Bringo's doing a great job, and Mint and Shades getting the frags. That Dragon Blade was very, very nice. Came at just the right moment to separate the support away from the just recently nano boosted Reinhardt. As he moved forwards, all of a sudden, all the support are under attack. So very nicely timed there from Bringo's, and that's going to keep them in the running. But there's still so much work to do, and IP have overall looked a bit better, and they still have a couple ultimates to work with, the four Hulk and also Primal Rage. And there's nothing for Bringo's ultimate-wise to deal with this as the push comes in.
Now Ladano is going to get an easy kill. He's put to sleep, but not for long. He'll be woken right back up. That said, a couple kills now going the way of NIP. They have a slight advantage, ever so slight, just one person advantage right now, but Mafu and the rest of his team will be moving forward. Zappe will respond, though. That's a big Graviton Surge, going to just get one, but that is enough. That is enough. Zappe will get two, and back to the drawing board for NIP. They're going to be looking to maybe base this next fight off something like the Nano Boost, and Zap is very, very close to getting yet another. It's one of the things that you see about every Ana play is it just, that ultimate gets up so quickly, simply because she can heal so fast. If you've got tanks, if you've got multiple tanks, maybe even three, it's going to go even faster.
And they really need to try to trade two ultimates for maybe three of Bringo, so they need to find a way to get that ultimate advantage, and the Nano Boost Reinhardt combo could be what does it. And there we go, we've got it. Ryu's on Fraggy there as he runs in. He goes for the charge there, just charging everybody down. And that is beautiful there, partying the sea of Bringo's players with that charge. He swings for the heavens, trying to get the frags there, and they will be found. Looks amazing right now for NIP as they make back-to-back kills. And this is now looking almost almost impossible for Bringo's.
Yeah, they have to jump in right now. It's going to be D.Va to delay. D.Va's on the point, and that's one of the things she does best. It's going to be the sound barrier as well, so still not out of it here for Bringo's as they are filtering out ever so slowly, one at a time, from the spawn point. And the kills go, going the way of NIP. This should be a capture, but it is not a quick time. NIP really needs to get this done here and now. Otherwise, they're in a pretty bad spot, but the payload will roll into the final place. And NIP, they made it work with this off-kilter, off-standard composition.
Yeah, those hooks really made me laugh.
Yeah.
I mean, to some extent, of course, it was, you know, it looks like he was just catching some invisible part of the hitbox that just we couldn't see. But the thing at the same time is he obviously understands the positioning so incredibly well of a setup like this. Like, that one was the most remarkable one. It was the switch to Winston, I think, which did give them that the push in what was otherwise a very difficult streets phase for them.
Yeah, they definitely were slowed down for quite some time. And this was actually a huge play. You can't overstate how important it was that he got that one pin there that gave them yet another big advantage in that final phase there. Bringo's. We'll see what they bring out on attack, and NIP likewise, what they bring out on defense. Will it be the same thing? Will it be that same composition? I mean, just thinking out loud, you know, Ana's Nano Boost does tend to be a little bit more useful on attack, but just the pure survivability of this defensive lineup, if they're able to keep Himsey alive on the Roadhog on defense, and he's able to even just hit every second or third hook, that's probably going to be enough. I mean, I don't see how Bringo's gets in if Himsey is alive.
That's very true, and can't wait to see some more hooks out of Himsey, to be honest.
Always fun and exciting to see Roadhogs pull those out of those miracles out.
Yep.
One of the things about Roadhog is you want to be throwing the hook every single time it's on cooldown. Even if you're not sure you're going to get the kill, a lot of the times he's predicting, hey, I think there might be somebody up here. You know, he has the game knowledge. He's played on this map dozens, if not hundreds of times. So he knows, and he knows that the more hooks you throw, the more you're going to hit, regardless of the fact that you may not know exactly where they're at.
You miss every shot you don't take.
That's right. I've heard that
Thank
somewhere.
Thank you. Isn't it Wayne Gretzky?
Yeah, something
yeah.
like that.
Anyway.
Some real sports thing.
Yeah. Well, we have a much more standard setup indeed from Bringo's, not having a Tracer to go with the Genji, but they have the McCree, and that's going to give them a lot of power on these mid-ranges, should he be able to connect those shots. But there's Oak coming in to try to force the fight there, as NIP are looking to get themselves in, and Himsey's getting pushed straight forwards there, straight into the mix. Nice catch onto Ladano, no escape for you. Oh my god, everybody's on the meat hooks today.
they're flanking the flankers. So Bringo's looking for a big flank, moving up onto the left side, but in a super aggressive push from Himzy, he said, I see you out there, I see you trying to go up the staircase, and I'm gonna have none of that. I'm actually a little surprised though, Bringo's not able to collapse in on Himzy as he made that happen for his team. Maybe a little bit of miscommunication, something like that. Himzy looking for an early pick, but not able to collect. That said, we do have Shades now switching onto a Reaper, and that makes a lot of sense to get against a three-tank composition.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I can't wait to see how this one actually pans out as well. And we'll see the next push coming in from Bringo's push number two. This is where NIP were able to get it done. Earthshatter comes in. Everybody's on the ground as the nano boost is live. And Fraggy is taking kill after kill there. Nice pin coming in. We see Reinhardt in the distance as Fraggy will push forwards now towards the spawn of Bringo's. And it looks like their second attack has failed.
Yeah, look at this hyper-aggression here. We have one in the back. It's going to be another hook coming out. Mint had no chance at all. He maybe could have tried to just play sneaky hidden in the health pack room and tried to make sure that they didn't see him. But nonetheless, still 2 minutes and 20 seconds left on the clock, which means Bringo's with four or five solid pushes as well. And they'll be able to engage with the Sound Barrier and the Transcendence for this next fight. They're very, very close to even a Graviton Surge as well, so let's see if they can get any value. It's Mafu who will be pulling the Graviton Surge out first, and it's going to be three or four for Bringo's caught in it. Only one kill taken, but one kill is likely enough. That they also, Nutty B, dropped the Sound Barrier there, so Bringo's without their Sound Barrier for this next fight, and Mafu and team, NIP, looking pretty good.
Yeah, I mean, that was just, again, another fantastic push. And just the fact that NIP, with all the meat to their lineup, are able to be able to push out so far each time to just deflect these attacks really puts Bringo's in these horrible situations. We can see so far the Reaper pick hasn't really been able to get them much damage because they just can't get Shades into position where he's able to get a few shots off for free.
Yeah, I mean, I feel like the Reaper almost needs to be comboed with a Winston or something to at least open this up a little bit. This could be a big Deadeye, though, getting a few skulls behind that Reinhardt shield. One kill going the way of Bringo's, and they're trying their best to move on in here. Fraggy actually a little bit out of position on defense here, and his Reinhardt shield very low. But Mafu will be coming through with a ton of charge, getting three kills in a row for his team, and this is looking better and better for NIP. Worse and worse for Bringo's, who only have really one more chance.
Yeah, and I think, if I'm not mistaken, Fraggy hit like a very nice fire strike. I think it maybe went through two or three players, just as Mafu got a nice, you know, Zarya ball in there, and that was pretty destructive. Love to see that. And the Graviton Surge, oh no, this could be so devastating. There it is! And that's everybody caught by it, as all of NIP start to surround them. There is nowhere to go. Bringo's once again lay on the ground, decimated. NIP, they're just all over this.
Yeah, risky play by NIP. I mean, Fraggy was brought down to less than 100 health, but in the end, he's able to survive. He's got three supports backing him up. And I lied, DDK, there's still one more chance for Bringo's to try and strike back. They still have 3 minutes and 50 seconds on the clock, so if they can get it right here and now, it's still possible. Shades needs to get a huge death blossom right here and now.
Oh, but the Earthshatter comes in. Fraggy, again, this guy has been on point all day so far, and there is no taking this point, but three, four kills. We get the Death Blossom coming in right at the end. Shades with the money play, and that might just be enough right now to allow Bringo's to at least claim the payload, but it needs to move so far, and they don't have a huge amount of time.
I'm pretty sure Shades just got three or four kills. Shades and Yuri got three or four kills when they were down, what, 2 versus 6? 3 versus 6?
I think he was put on his back at some point as well before that. So
yeah, he
I
was knocked down by the Reinhardt. I actually thought Shades was out of that fight already.
Agreed.
That said, only 3 minutes left. A miracle play by Shades will put the team of Bringo's into a position where they can still win. But it's going to be damn difficult. They really can only afford to be wiped maybe three times here, but they've got to be able to push this payload basically unfettered from here on out.
And the Bringo's start to move, and this tanky play isn't very interesting. Another Graviton there to throw into the mix just has to work and out and find out the money moment for that one. Looks like Mafu might be going in towards the back. And NIP, they have so many ultimates. If they stagger them correctly, they could really cause a lot of issues for Bringo's. Oh my god, everything's coming off at once at the moment. Absolutely every ultimate's down, and it's only NIP with the frags. This is not a good look for Bringo's, although NIP did expend a lot of ultimates there.
Now the golden hammer for Fraggy swinging away, and as you said before, swinging for the moon. He's able to get everything. Number of kills going in just a matter of seconds. Himzy gonna get the first hook as well, but not a kill. So, still a chance in this fight as the Transcendence is popped. Gonna heal everyone up for Bringo's as this is moving forward. There's a Death Blossom as well, but Himzy, Mafu, and I really have to call out Fraggy. He has hit so many clutch Earth Shatters for his team. That said, this fight rages on. His kills have been drawn from both sides. Bringo's still in it, but no, NIP gonna crush the dreams, crush the hopes, and with 1 minute and 42 seconds left on the clock, it almost doesn't feel mathematically possible anymore, DDK.
Yeah. Yeah, this is such a cool setup to see from NIP. And as you said, I completely agree. Fraggy has been amazing. With a lot of the fire strikes, even have been very on point to build up those fast Earth Shadows. He's been nailing those. He's been getting loads of great charges in his positioning on his team's been great. And Himzy as well. I mean, a lot of the players from NIP have been doing excellent work, and the GGs will be cool. NIP are going to be taking Hollywood.
Yeah, absolutely refreshing here to be able to sing the praises of tanks instead of. You know, we're constantly talking about this DPS outclassing that DPS and the huge plays, the huge ultimates, the Death Blossoms, the swords. But in this game, it was all about the Graviton Surges and, of course, the Earth Shatters making so much happen, the hooks as well. So fantastic stuff. And gotta give credit where credit is due. NIP has pioneered this strategy of three tanks and three supports. They're one of the only teams that actually plays this. And they've played it to great effect against a talented team. In Bringo's.
And it's really funny because we could really see that Bringo's in many spots are like, well, we have a really good catch-all setup in a composition-wise. Okay, we'll switch to the Reaper, but that's not really, that's, you know, pretty standard as well to get that out there. But it felt like they just couldn't find the right way to attack what was this beautiful, I say beautiful because I was really, really enjoying it. As you mentioned, triple tank setup coming in from NIP. So that's going to be very disheartening when you just keep bashing your head against the wall, seemingly. And you can't find the answer.
Yeah, and you know we did see, of course, the Reaper come out, which should be the natural enemy of a three-tank push. But yeah, there was no way for him to get on into the action. There was no big distractions. There was no Winston jumping in and dropping a barrier, something like that. They weren't able to combo with maybe Speed Boost and Zarya Bubble as well as they maybe should have or could have. So unfortunate for Bringo's, they looked a little bit stumped on attack. That said, not the fastest time set out of the Finnish team either. We're going to be switching on to Dorado next, which is another map where we've seen NIP play with this three tank, three support combination. We might see it again, DDK.
I'm happy. I mean, I think we even would have probably seen it on Hanamura. I think I would actually have loved to see either map, to be honest, because the setup is just so interesting to see how from once, you know, just having lost against it, if somehow Bringo's can find out a way to defeat it. We did see some fun stuff with the Maywalls actually on the first point on offense and defense previously yesterday. I don't know if that's, you know, a mix up that they might like want to go for to try to isolate some of the tanks as they move forwards. Or perhaps they just want to try to rely upon the basics, the stuff that they know is tried and tested, that they're confident with, and maybe Dorado is a map that they just generally feel a bit better on. We'll have to see. So you get a very nice pan over the ocean, all those ships at night.
You know, one thing I will say about this map, I think it might favor Bringo slightly more simply because there's so many more ledges for Reaper to kind of flank from, to fall off, down from. Of course, Reaper always best when you're flanking, when you're coming from an angle where the NIP may be not quite ready for it, especially with that Death Blossom. So Reaper might come into play in a bigger way here, but in the instant hook, it's going to be death for Mint. Mint taken down immediately as Himzy just speed boosted right into the action. I don't think they were expecting that speed boosted Roadhog to come right into their face.
Yeah, I think you're completely right. I don't think they expected that timing at all. And just already picking up the Reinhardt is so far to run from the spawn there. And you can see that NIP are already in the marketplace. And Bringo's, this is not the right foot for them to start off on after losing the first map in the way that they did. And this is going to be very, very hard for them now. We've got Shades there trying to get some damage in from the back, but again, there's so many tanks here. It just takes so much damage to get them down, and finally Reinhardt rejoins the fray, and the push, the initiation is made, and it's actually working right now. Bringo's getting the shots off that they need.
Number of kills unresponded by NIP there as Bringo's cleaning things up, and they were able to collapse a lot more efficiently on this map than Hollywood. You know, Hollywood, you know, the way it's just structured, you see the attack coming from a mile away. On Dorado, there's so many opportunities to flank and come from the side. Exactly what we're seeing right now. Ladano comes from the back. Very ballsy play there to come basically by himself. Only Shades and Ladano come from the side. But that's three kills in a row. And even though we saw Ladano get that early pick, it just did not work out as NIP have been able to clean up.
I mean, yeah, the early pick, but it's interesting because if you know they feel like they're going for that timing, they're investing in the timing where they feel like, okay, if we go in now, we expect them to be just pushing at this phase, we can catch off the support. But again, with the setup that NIP have, even if you catch off one of the supports, because you don't have these squishy DPSs around them that need to be sustained all the time, instead that you have the tanks, they actually have a lot of ability to just keep the push going. So this is problematic. Oh no! Another great hook coming in. Himzy, somehow he's stealthy with a Roadhog.
Yeah. Ah, the flanking Roadhog, classic. Because Himzy isn't able to draw blood there, but still will disrupt things a little bit. I think they've caught out the Genji. He's looking for another hook. Will he be able to get this Genji? Oh, so close. I feel like if that hook was just a centimeter higher, it would have actually hit.
Yeah, he knows his stuff, and looks like the Graviton Surge will come in as Gringos go for that initiation, and the die, the Death Blossom will come in. And actually, you know what? I think NIP are pretty happy with that. They didn't really expend any of their own ultimates there. That said, there are a lot more to be used by Bringos. So Bringos only using the Death Blossom and Graviton combo, still with the Transcendence, the Sound Barrier, the Earth Shadow, they still have a lot to work with. So NIP need to try to burn off some more ultimates here. Bringos did very well at not using too many, I have to say.
Yeah, both support ultimates here for Bringos. So how can NIP start to force these out? And there comes the Sound Barrier for the defense. Mapu will be dropping a big Graviton Surge potentially. He's able to get quite a few kills as Zapis and Himzy now combining for a few themselves. And this is looking good now for NIP. They've gotten four in a row, and they'll surely be able to push very, very close to this next point. Just maybe barely time for Bringos to jump on in and try to delay, try to stop this payload from moving forward. But it's going to have to be Heroics out of Shade. And does he even want to risk dying here? I think they might just concede this one. Still enough time, though. What will they decide to do? Shades could do it for his team, potentially. Here comes the collapse, perhaps. Yes, it is, indeed. And all of Bringo's going to be jumping onto the point. They'll be using several ultimates, and this is a risky play, but if it pays off, it will pay off in droves, as they will be able to hold this point.
Yeah, to pop all their ultimates to get this one done, but NIP will counter with their own, and as we see, tank on tank action, but it's hard to avoid that when NIP are playing. Oh, nice catch! And that's another hook coming in, but the frag is made by the Genji. Shades pulls that out of the bag there. That's a very crucial kill, actually, as it does look like Bringos are doing a good job here to hold on.
Yeah, if Shades wasn't able to reflect the brunt of that Roadhog blast, then I think that could have gone very much a different way. That said, Mapu and Co. still looking for this flanking angle. Lodano taken down so low. He'll be able to Wraith walk away, though. Taken down low again, and here comes the nano boosted. Reinhardt going to be getting into everyone's face, disrupting things, making everyone scatter for the hills. And this, in all likelihood, could be the point here for NIP. That said, both teams still with a decent amount of people on the point. Mint looking for the charge, but I think he got killed there before he was able to get it. That means that this has snowballed out of control. NIP will get the point, and they're moving on a decent pace, kind of middling though. What is this? Shades now switching on to Pharah. Are we going to see a Pharah again? We retreated a little bit of Pharah action last night, and it was certainly refreshing to see.
Yeah, and it makes a lot of sense in many ways because of all the tanks. They don't have the McCree. The only thing I would worry about is those eerily accurate hooks that Himzy's been launching. But I feel like that's the only thing they have to worry about. We'll have to see how that comes into play as a very fast push emerges on the upper bridge. Let's see if it works out here for NIP as they try to force the engagement. The payload will move a lot during this distraction, and so that's actually going to work out for NIP. So far, so good for them.
Yeah, the payload continues to move, and this is a kind of a strange flank for Bringos on defense, but it does end up working. They've pushed NIP off, and NIP will have to come from a different angle this time. It's going to be a ton of ultimates up, though, for this next fight. The only thing that Bringos has advantage here is that they're going to have that sound barrier to help engage. Will they use it engage right here? It's going to be Zarya Bubble keeping that Roadhog alive. Here comes Lodano from above, and once again, this map just has seemed suited so much better for Lodano. He's found these angles, he's found these drops, but four kills now for NIP. They're so close to setting a time here at the end of Dorado. They're going to be able to get this payload so close to the end, but one last chance for Bringos to slow it down.
Yeah, this is looking great right now, and I'm loving the action with the nano boosts on the Reinhardt. It's really paying off, and a nice charge there. That's going to make life a little bit more complicated as we see the collapse here, the surround from Bringos as they try to mount a Hail Mary to stop this payload reaching all the way. But so far, it's looking inevitable that it will be going the way of NIP as they get frag after frag, although, of course, being so close to the spawn, this time it's not going to matter, and NIP are going to secure it. They are looking great, but how do you feel about the time there? It didn't look super fast.
Yeah, it's a pretty decent time. It's fine, and I think one of the things about this composition for NIP is it's not really built to jump on in instantaneously, get the super fast pick. I mean, the only way that they're going to get that pick is with Himsey. Himsey has to hit these huge hooks for his team. And so ultimately, pretty okay for NIP. And as we switch on over, we'll see what comes on out of Bringos. Will it be this dive composition that's sort of being coined these days? These last couple of weeks, everyone's been talking about the dive composition. Will we see something like that from Bringos? And I certainly think that that could be what they need. If they're able to snowball, if they're able to get the first objective very quickly and gain an ult advantage, then they're certainly going to have a good opportunity to beat this time. But at this point, I'm not even wondering if NIP is going to pull this strategy out again. It just seems like this is what they're playing with now, especially on these payload maps.
Yeah, and I have to say I would very much like to see another Pharah. I mean, again, if the only real problem for the Pharah is perhaps the primary fire of Ana from Zapis, or maybe it's going to be the hook, but and maybe the Zenyatta. But if you're smart with your positioning, as we saw last night in North America with Wyatt playing the Pharah, then again, you know, you can mitigate a lot of those problems if you just understand how to position yourself, how to cut off line of sight. And because the rockets are a projectile, you know, you can launch them in, don't be too high in the sky and make yourself an easy target. The concussive blast as well is of very, very good utility, especially on payload as well. So definitely some pros there. But again, you don't want to be necessarily going for something that you're not very used to playing. You know, like you want to be practiced and feel comfortable. So I can understand why they wouldn't bring it out in the initial as the initial setup.
All right, taking a look at Bringo's composition. They are running with both the Tracer and the Genji, so that's part of this dive composition, but they don't have Winston.
Yeah.
So not really the full thing that we've been seeing so much here. And Shade's actually in a ton of danger. He's going to get hooked right away. And Himsey has started off almost every single map with a big hook. Here, no different. And if you take a look at the positioning for NIP, holy hell are they far forward. You don't see this super often, as they've taken a super aggressive defensive stance here on the first point of Dorado. This is kind of looking like a pub. In a pub, I'm like, hey guys, move back. We want to be behind the arches. That's where the biggest choke point, or the smallest choke point, rather,
is. I hope the NIP aren't giving people in public the ideas, man, because I think it only works with this composition, and they know that. And here come the hooks. They have so much sustainability. Shade's going to get himself a couple frags, but they answer back with the tanks. They might have to start thinking about pulling back because the respawn advantage is definitely there for Bringos. That said, NIP did pretty much wipe them, so we won't see them falling back too far, perhaps, because this is wasting a lot of time. The payload has barely moved, but they indeed will take a slightly more defensive position.
Now, one of the reasons that actually staying that far forward isn't a terrible idea is because even if you are wiped on defense, you actually still have plenty of time to get back and stop the capture at that first point. Himsey, though, starting this engagement out. Well, again, NIP. They're off the back of Fraggy, off the back of Himsey. They're able to just do incredible work, incredible amounts of damage, and two kills means that Bringos has to slow down, has to stop once again, and they're not even able to build up a ton of ultimates at this rate. I mean, Nutty B isn't even finding anyone to heal because the kills are just happening in a split second.
It's so funny to see, you know, Himsey and Fraggy going up on the side like they were like a McCree and a Genji or something, and there's like a Reinhardt and a Roadhog. It's just absolutely brilliant stuff coming in here from NIP. Beautiful style to this composition as they push off Bringos once again off the payload, and again, getting aggressive, throwing in the hooks there. It doesn't seem like Bringos can easily break this. A lot of time is being wasted, too much time, in fact, really.
And even the Dragon Blade pulled out, but he was trying to slice and dice a hog. And that takes way too many swings. Not able to get the work done, and now Shades needs to wait again for his ultimate, and a couple ultimates pulled out. Will they be able to get any value? Zappy gets the Pulse Bomb, finally! Finally, Bringos found some kind of combination that worked for them, and this should, in theory, be this next point. But with 3 minutes and 45 seconds on the clock, not exactly a fast time. Well, excuse me, only a minute 30 left on the game clock, but 3 minutes and 30 seconds left now on the stopwatch as they have to get through these next couple of points very, very fast.
Yep, and as you said, you know, it did take them ages to work in the ultimates. And that's pretty cool because it means Himsey's doing a good job not getting shot at all the time, because that's one of the downsides of a Roadhog, is that he kind of just generates so much ultimate, as opposed to Reinhardt, who can just soak up your damage with his shield. And we will see just classic high ground positioning, looking for the dive. And as far as the ultimates they have to work with, well, they have an Earth Shatter, they have a Nano Boost. That's pretty much all they need. The Sound Barrier as a desperation switch, perhaps. But they should be good to go in for an initiation very, very soon now.
So the team comms will come. And here is the initiation. It's going to be the Nano Boost. Will we see the Earth Shatter as well? We might in just a second. That said, everyone kind of protected and not really bunched on up too much. So Fraggy hasn't been able to find the value that we have come to expect from him. And a couple of ultimates now wasted here for NIP, as they're being kind of squashed at this point.
Yeah, they really missed the mark there on the sort of team coordination, the spatial awareness of how Bringos were actually bringing the attack. We saw, of course, one of the rare times that Fraggy wasn't able to get really any value out of the Nano Boost on the Reinhardt and the charges and so on. So that's going to bode very well for Bringos as they move all the way through the church phase and looking to capture the second point. But there can still be another dive. There is a Graviton Surge, there is an Earth Shadow, but no Sound Barrier.
Exactly, waiting in the flank, looking for another big pulse bomb. Ladano, though, doesn't have the Graviton Surge, so he's going to have to do it by himself. Himzy, though, getting a kill. Fraggy will as well, and this is easy-peasy hold now for NIP, barring some kind of miracle. So with 2 minutes and 2 seconds left on the clock, it's got to be flawless play from here on out. Bringos has to find a way to combo again, potentially that the Graviton Surge and the pulse bomb. Without that, doesn't seem like they've been able to make much happen.
Yeah, and it's quite cool again to see all the success from the Ana and the tank composition. And they close it down though. We get the next initiation being found here for NIP as they go for the collapse. And we see the Graviton Surge being dropped there in the midst of the point of the payload, rather, as Himzy pulls out the full hog. He will go down eventually, but not after. We see the screen flooded with red right now as all the frags are going towards NIP, and it's just a few stragglers left alive in Mintz and Ladano and Zappy. But how much longer can they stay alive, or can they even escape here to prevent the staggered respawns? Looks like Zappy's going to get out of there, but a lot of time wasted. Once again, Bringos, the only thing going for them right now is that they have the ultimate advantage, and perhaps that was all they were looking for going into that last fight.
But they've got to be finding a way to use these ultimates right here and now and get a ton of value. They have they're coming from a flanking angle, but no one's really too bunched up at this point. It looks like a couple people will be, but the Transcendence will come out. Transcendence is good. Zap will get the Pulse Bomb, though, and this Pulse Bomb Graviton Surge combo has been what we've seen time and time again, the saving grace for a whole bunch of teams. That said, with only 40 seconds, is there even time left for Bringos? They might be going down 0-2 against their Finnish counterparts. The Swedes will be falling here if they're not able to make a miracle happen, and doesn't look like it's going to be possible. Even though they're getting the kills, they have to go just too far. This payload needs to round the bend. Even though they're pushing on aggressive, and they made that last fight look very strong for them, I'm expecting to see GG's called out very, very soon here. Just isn't enough time. It will be NIP taking the first win, and you know what their prize is? It's going to be facing off in the upper bracket. There's going to be some tough matches ahead of them, where it will be Bringos dropping down.
It's last attempt here coming in, and that is a big pick, especially as the Pulse Bomb was ready. And we've seen a lot of value coming out of that Pulse Bomb, as the burst damage on all those tanks has been very, very strong. But yeah, it's the GG's called NIP. I am so happy that they found success, because again, they found it with an amazing composition that we're not used to seeing, but they showed us real strategical applications to it, where they make the aggressive style work when they're defending. And of course, when they're going in for the pushes on the initial point, this kind of success rate they can have with that in the very first couple pushes. So that was a lot of fun.
Yeah, definitely fun. We've seen this team do it before. They did it again against another rival team, a similar skill level to them. But to break down that match more, we've been rejoined, of course, by our good friends, Josh and Seltzer.
Thanks so much, guys. Great to be back here. And wow, that was some matches there, and we saw Hollywood, we saw Dorado. Mostly, we saw that the Swedes couldn't finish. So, Josh, you break it down for us.
The Swedes couldn't finish because the other guys finished. Yeah. Anyway, it was a good match, I think, for NIP. Of course, they showed us that composition that we talked about a little bit before the match with the triple support, triple tank. In the qualifiers, they broke it out for the first time. They set like 3-minute times on the payload maps back then. It wasn't as effective this time around against a Bringo squad, which put up a bit of a fight. But Himzy, with the most ridiculous hooks of all time, like not just one or two, but 5 or 6 or 7 actually ridiculous hooks throughout that. I gotta give it all to Himsey on that one for the great offense and defense. I'm sure we're going to see a ton of them here in the highlight reel. He's mastered pulling people without even seeing them. Do you see that? That's like two pixels on Zen on the top of that roof in the back. Rachel, me, ZP, Joro, we're all just like, what? And he just did it time after time. Everything was great from Himsey. I also got to give big props. You were giving props to Fraggy for some great play. Mafu hit every Graviton Surge perfectly. Every single one had something like three people inside of it. So all the tank play coming out from NIP, actually just beautiful stuff across the board.
So tell me a little bit about what kind of factor Ana was in this fight. You know, we talk about this as a three support, three tank meta. There's a lot of discussion about Zarya actually being DPS in a big way, but where does Ana fall? Is she fully support? Because she does contribute a lot to the damage done by the team.
I think it's similar to Zenyatta actually puts out more healing than Ana typically. Mm-hmm. Ana is almost like a flex DPS slash healer in the way that Roadhog is a slash flex tank slash DPS. So it's actually well-rounded when you look at it all, and it's a good sustained composition for that reason. Ana can actually put out damage. Just always be shooting is basically her mantra. If she's not having to heal anyone, she can push out damage. And Nano Boost is more of an offensive ult than a defensive one like you've got from Zenyatta or Lucio. So it actually creates a really nice blend. And NIP, they've clearly been practicing this for weeks. You can see another ridiculous hook on that Reinhardt where I was like, how in the world did he actually do that? Defying gravity and physics, but it worked out every time. Genji, he hooked Genji so many times, like mid-dash or just jumping all around. Himsey, I definitely got to give props again just for his great hooks.
Yeah, it felt like Bringos, they were only really able to get much friction when they were having huge flanks. You know, they were playing with both the Reaper and the Genji a lot of the time, either Reaper Genji or Genji Tracer. So they were only really able to make it happen when they were catching NIP off guard, diving into their backline. That's, of course, what those characters are known for. But there on the last on Dorado on attack, they only really made a ton of progress if it was some huge play from Ladano on Reaper or a Tracer Pulse Bomb. One of the two. That's what they completely relied on, it felt like.
Mm-hmm. Zaffy specifically with some really good Pulse Bomb multi-kills. Dan, what do you think about the fact that this triple support, triple tank is so, you know, unique, and they are using it against some teams like Bringos quite effectively, and in the qualifiers it was quite effective, but they're up against Reunited next. Do you think this composition is going to hold out?
It's really hard to say. One thing that I will say about it, though, is that it's clear how much work they've put in optimizing it and understanding exactly how that dynamic works, because again, we saw uncharacteristic, almost pub-like aggression on Dorado on defense on the first point. Like, you never normally will ever see that, because normally you have all these DPSs to worry about, and you know it can snowball out of control very quickly, but they have so much sustainability, and with Himsey hitting all these hooks, almost these stealth hooks as well, like ninja hooks, I don't even know what that is, but it's very clear they understand the dynamics there. And the thing with Reunited is they have so much amazing individual skill. It's going to be a great test, actually, for the kind of proven current meta versus what is a team that is very specialized and has the individual skill to back it up. So I feel like Reunited, of course, they're going to be massive favorites, but I'm just looking forward to seeing how the styles clash at this point.
All right, well, let's check out the incredible play of the game brought to us by Republic of Gamers and see which clash we're going to highlight here. A lot of great ones. A lot of multi-kills in this match.
Yeah, I think there was a quad pulse bomb. Yeah. I think that's what I'm looking for from Zaffy, perhaps.
Well, there was the quad ult from Fraggy as well on Reinhardt, where he took out four of them.
Oh, maybe it's actually a compilation of Himsey ridiculous. Yeah, it is, actually. Just every actual ridiculous hook that we saw. Genji here getting snagged. Pulled all which direction he can be pulled.
So in this case, one was it's great. Like the incredible player of the game.
Yeah, which totally.
Himsey making it work. And whenever you see a Roadhog just pull these ridiculous hooks out of nowhere, seemingly, I mean, we've seen this from a ton of other teams as well. But when it happens like this, it just feels like a highlight reel every time. Each hook feels so satisfying to see and to collect.
Well, it's really interesting because Himsey used to be the Reaper player, and Roadhog is the great tank analog for that. And it's not about just, you know, left-clicking, running through, death blossoming. It's all about the hook combo. It's one and done. He doesn't even have to worry about it.
And how much, you know, studying he had to do, how much awareness he has to have on the map just to be able to pull with these so little sight lines, you know, and the snap decisions he makes too. Because he's not, like, looking
super
up there.
Reactions.
He's not scanning the rooftops. He's like, I bet. Yeah, you know, it's like Obama catching a fly. Like, it was super cool. So really exciting to see. Talk to us about some of the other plays that we saw from Bringos that might be helpful to them as they go forward. They're going to be playing against B-Fly, and I'm wondering how that's going to match up.
I think that they're going to have an okay time against B-Fly. B-Fly is actually a pretty good team. If you look at their roster, they've got guys like Faz from Quake, guys from like Outsider who actually formerly played with the current Dignitas squad at the very beginning of the Overwatch scene. So B-Fly is looking good, but also I think Bringo's has a little bit more experience. They've been a little bit more stable of a roster. But again, I really do feel like that they were completely reliant on these huge plays. I mean, even if you looked on Hollywood, it looked like they weren't even going to be able to get the first point until there was just a massive play out of Ladano able to come from behind. So hoping to see some more of that, and it's going to come down to that Graviton Surge, Pulse Bomb, and or Death Blossom combo, as it frequently does, but seems like they rely on this bit more than other teams.
All right. Well, before we get into that losers match between B-Fly and Bringo's, we are going to be back with the winners match between Ninjas in Pajamas and Reunited. That's going to be right after this break.